There are more planets in our universe than grains of sand here on Earth, and so far, life has only ever been found on one. But astronomers are looking. Right now, they are searching through our galaxy for Earth 2.0, a rocky world with oceans of water filled with life. And if we're lucky, an intelligent alien civilization we can talk to. 100 years ago, scientists would have told you this is impossible, but it's not. And each day we are getting closer. In fact, some scientists are already convinced that we have found proof of life on some of these mysterious worlds. Put simply, exoplanets are just planets in the universe that don't orbit our sun. We believe that they existed for hundreds of years despite having no evidence or any detections, until eventually our technology became good enough to let us detect these mysterious little worlds. Back in the 1600s, there was an Italian philosopher named Giordano Bruno, who was far ahead of his time. Bruno believed that the universe has no center and that the stars in the sky are just like our sun, with their own set of planets and moons surrounding them. In fact, it was this very belief that had him tried for heresy by the Roman Inquisition, as these facts went against the Catholic beliefs of the time. He was found guilty and burned at the stake. Perhaps the first believer in these wonderful worlds, burnt at the stake for getting it right. As of right now, we have confirmed the existence of around 5,500 exoplanets, with another 10,000 candidates awaiting confirmation. And some of the planets we have found are actually unbelievable. I'm talking planets with rings 600 times larger than Saturn, ocean worlds with water covering all of the planet's surface, planets where it rains molten glass, and even lonely worlds who don't orbit a star drifting throughout the galaxy in search of a friend. And the crazy thing is, 5,000 seems like a lot, right? I mean, we have just 8 planets in our solar system, 9, I guess, if you include Pluto, but we haven't even scratched the surface. This is our Milky Way galaxy. It contains 100 to 200 billion individual stars, most of which have planets orbiting them. Now, when I tell you that we have found 5,000 exoplanets, you probably imagine something like this, right? But in reality, we've only searched the star systems really close to us. This is where you are, and these are all of the detected exoplanet systems. We've barely begun our search. In our galaxy alone, there are hundreds of billions of planets left for us to discover. Now, if I asked you to go out and find me an exoplanet, you would probably do it by pointing a telescope at a star and zooming in really closely until you could see the little planets orbiting it, right? Similar to how we might find Saturn or Jupiter in our solar system. But it's not that easy. You see, most stars are really bright and much larger than the planets orbiting them. And that's a big problem if we want to try and take a picture of these exoplanets. You can think of it like trying to take a picture of a firefly right beside one of those huge stadium floodlights from a mile away. When the light is off, you can see a faint glow of a firefly. But as soon as the light is turned on, the glow of the firefly immediately disappears. And that's exactly the problem we run into with trying to image these exoplanets. The star is just too bright for us to reliably take pictures of them. Of the 5,500 exoplanets we've discovered, just 69 of them were discovered using this direct imaging technique. Now, this method works by using a coronagraph or a starshade to block out as much of the star's light as possible in order for us to see these faint planets in their orbit. But this only really works for huge planets like Jupiter that orbit really far away from their star. In this video, we can see 4 super Jupiters orbiting their home star. The closest planet we can see here is nearly as far away from its star as Uranus is from our sun, and this one all the way out here orbits further than Pluto. So if we want to find lots of exoplanets, and hopefully find one that's similar to Earth, we need to try some new methods. Now, I want to just take a moment to thank the sponsor of today's video, Notion. Now, this isn't a normal YouTube ad read. You see, I have personally been using Notion services for 3 or 4 years, long before they ever decided to work with me. Notion recently launched their new AI personal assistant, a tool that just helps you to work better. You can use it to accurately translate between languages, summarize blocks of text into easy to understand content, or even use it to brainstorm ideas. Recently, I've been exploring with the Explain This feature, in which Notion AI can take a block of text, understand it, and explain it back to you in a way that just makes sense. This helps a lot when it comes to understanding some really complex topics that you just might not have background knowledge of. They've also added a Q&A feature recently that lets you ask Notion AI a question, and it will search through your entire Notion database to pull out the answer for you. You can use it to study for class, work on a side hustle, or even help you with planning for dinner. The opportunities are really endless. So I suggest you get started with Notion for free and then unlock the power of AI for just $10 a month. Again, I have personally used their services for many years now and I can't recommend them enough. So thank you again to Notion for supporting the channel. Now let's go find some planets. The earliest method used to find these elusive planets actually uses gravity to detect them. You see, when a planet orbits a star, the star doesn't just stay still. The planet actually pulls on the star ever so slightly. This causes the star to move in tiny circles or ellipse patterns. And when we look at the star in our sky, we can see the star wobbling ever so slightly. This wobble causes the spectrum of light to change ever so slightly. As the star comes towards us during its circle motion, it appears ever so slightly bluer, and as it moves away from us, it appears a tiny bit red. Of the 5,500 exoplanets found so far, just over 1,000 of them were found using this radial velocity method. But because this method relies on the planet tugging on the star, it only really works well for really big planets that orbit very close to their star. And most of the detections occur using these big ground-based telescopes instead of the ones in space. Using this method, astronomers found the planet Gliese 667cc. This planet actually orbits a triple star system 24 light years away from us. If you were on this planet, you would see 3 suns in your sky instead of just one. Unfortunately, this method just simply doesn't work well for finding small planets orbiting far away from their star. They just don't tug on the star strong enough for us to detect it. Now, if there were an alien civilization on a planet 100 light years away and they had similar technology to us, they would have no chance of detecting Earth using this method. They might find Jupiter, but that's really about it. So if the goal is to find Earth 2.0, a small rocky world orbiting in the star's habitable zone, we're gonna need to try something new, and that is where the transit method comes in. Imagine you were outside on a sunny day looking at the sun when you suddenly see a bird fly in front of the sun. This blocks some of the sunlight from reaching you, causing the brightness to dim just for a moment. This is essentially how the transit method works. As a planet orbits its star, it will sometimes pass between us and the star, blocking out some of the light, allowing us to detect the planet. We actually get to see this in our own solar system when Venus transits across the sun. Now, when NASA launched the Kepler Space Telescope in 2009, their goal was to find an Earth-sized exoplanet by looking at around 500,000 individual stars and closely watching to see if they were dimming at all. Now, by looking at the same stars over multiple years, they can very precisely measure how many planets are orbiting the star and how long it takes them to orbit. If you spot the same dip in brightness every 100 days, that's a good sign of a planet. This method has been by far the most useful and has been responsible for detecting over 80% of all the exoplanets we have detected thus far. And using it, they have found planets like the TRAPPIST-1 system. This system of 7 rocky worlds huddled tightly around their red dwarf star might be our best shot at detecting evidence for life elsewhere in the universe. And the James Webb Space Telescope is already looking. But it's of course not perfect. For example, if a planet just happens to be orbiting in a plane that doesn't cross the star from our point of view, we just won't see any brightness dip at all. And the best part about this method isn't even the fact that it lets us detect so many exoplanets. It's actually that we can use it to literally look and see what's happening in the atmospheres of these exoplanets and potentially find signs of life.
The search for life beyond this solar system is getting a big boost tonight.
Meanwhile, the discovery of a new exoplanet has astronomers excited that it could be indeed signs of life.
Now, I know that this sounds like magic, but here's how it works. As an exoplanet transits its host star, part of the light hitting the atmosphere is absorbed. The surviving starlight continues through the atmosphere, leaving the planet, and eventually we detect it using our telescopes. Now, each of the molecules in the atmosphere of the planet absorbs a slightly different bit of the starlight in a very special way, leaving behind a fingerprint, if you will, or signature in the surviving light. Now, this signature is locked into the starlight and remains unchanged as it travels across the entire universe, eventually hitting our telescopes. Now, once it reaches our telescopes, say JWST for example, we break up the starlight into all of the wavelengths or colors, forming a spectrum. And we notice something really interesting. Some of the colors in this spectrum are just missing. Now, these missing sections are the signatures of the elements and molecules that are found in the atmosphere of the exoplanet that it left. Then it's just a case of matching the signature to the elements and molecules that we know of. And boom, we know exactly what's floating around in the atmosphere of that planet that is billions and billions of kilometers away from Earth. Now, I believe this is the method we will use to find that smoking gun, the evidence for life beyond Earth. In fact, some people believe we've already done it. Now, just a few weeks ago, astronomers were analyzing the spectrum of one of these known ocean worlds, K2-18b, and they found something strange. Now, among things like methane and CO2, they found traces of a chemical known as dimethyl sulfide. Now, here on Earth, the only way we know this chemical is made is by microbial life. But there are some concerns. This is only a single detection, so much more evidence is needed to see whether this chemical is even present in this atmosphere, and whether microbial life is really the only explanation. There are already plans to spend more time observing this planet carefully. Now, I'm not sure whether they will confirm this result or not, but one thing is for certain. Our current technology is already good enough to find strong evidence for life outside of Earth. So, in my opinion, it's only a matter of time. Now, I would argue that the primary goal of exoplanet research at the moment is to find unmistakable, irrevocable evidence for life beyond Earth. Now, of course, that's not the only goal, and we get to learn a lot along the way, but that is, in my opinion, the main objective. And the day that we find that smoking gun, irrevocable proof that we are not alone in this universe, in my opinion, that might be the most important day in all of human history. And I would be willing to bet that it will probably happen in your lifetime. Now, when I say that we are looking for signs of life on these planets, I don't mean that we are using our telescopes to zoom right in on the planet and look for city lights or even little green men waving back at us. In fact, we aren't even really looking for radio signals or secret hidden messages sent by the aliens. Rather, we want to try and find signals sent by them just as a result of being alive. A study in 2020 found 1,004 stars in just the right positions aligned with Earth's orbital plane, allowing for a transit detection of Earth. Now, of these 1,004 stars, just two of them are known to host planets. This essentially means that if an alien civilization has evolved in either of these planetary systems and they have similar technology to ours, they could very literally detect Earth and potentially even find signs of life on it. They would need to watch our sun just like this and see the total brightness drop by 0.01% to the naked eye. This is of course completely unnoticeable, but using spectroscopy, they would understand so much about our planet. They would be able to measure the size and mass of our world and figure out it takes us 365 days to orbit the sun. And most importantly, they would be able to look at Earth's atmospheric spectra and notice something beautiful, the presence of oxygen. You see, oxygen was created by microbes here on Earth billions of years ago and has been sustained by life ever since. If all life on Earth died tomorrow, everything, every tree, human, bacteria, mushroom, the lot, Earth's oxygen would disappear in around 10 million years. Now, you compare that to the age of the universe, and that's nothing. But the detection of oxygen on an alien world isn't the smoking gun we are looking for. I mean, oxygen can be sustained by non-life as well. But rather, the goal is to find a full spectrum filled with biomarkers. Oxygen, water, methane, CO2, and many others. Now that is the smoking gun. If we are able to find Earth 2.0, a nice little rocky world filled with oceans, beautiful forests, and perhaps even a thriving civilization, we will have finally answered the single most important question ever asked. Are we alone? And the answer, no. No, we're not. Now, there are so many new telescopes and missions being launched in the coming years that will help in our search, revealing millions of potential safe havens for life. And this is why I'm so sure it will happen in our lifetime. And it's not even really about finding a backup planet. You see, as far as I'm concerned, we are pretty much stuck here in our solar system. With our current technology, it would take us more than 10,000 years to reach the nearest exoplanet to us, just 4 light years away. Earth is our only home. This isn't about trying to leave. It's about curiosity and trying to figure out what's out there and how we got here. The probability of finding life on one of these worlds is hard to estimate. But if we never search, our chances of succeeding will always be zero.